Welcome to the Labyrinth. If you find the podcast useful, please subscribe. My guest today is Baba Yaga. He has a beautiful channel on a beautiful page on Instagram called Men of Letters. The link to his Instagram page is in the description. He's sort of like a liberator of conscience. He talks about agorism. He talks about liberation of consciousness. So please do check out his page. It's brilliant. It's called Men of Letters. Baba Yaga, welcome to the Labyrinth, my friend.
Hi, how are you doing?
I'm good, how are you?
Yeah, I'm doing good, I'm doing very great.
So, what do you think of what's happening right now in the world with the pandemic and with the lockdowns and the direction the world is going in?
Mm-hmm. It has different perspectives, like different people have given different perspectives on it. And my perspective is more of a spiritual one because I am more into occult and spirituality. So I think it's a war between ideologies and it's like the humanity is diverging into two. And things are getting more clearer and clearer as the time is progressing. That's what I believe can be said initially about this. But we can discuss on this a lot because a lot of new unexpected things are happening. Even today, a lot of things have happened in my community as well. People are getting emotional and psychic attacks and a lot of stuff happening.
Psychic attacks within the community, you mean?
Like people get individual dream attacks, psychic attacks in their sleeps.
What is psychic attacks?
So basically psychic attacks they have different classifications, but the most usual one is that you get a sleep paralysis. Do you know about sleep paralysis?
Can you explain?
So the person is unconscious while they're sleeping. And the mind becomes conscious when a paralysis happens, sleep paralysis happens. The mind becomes conscious, but the body is still unconscious.
Okay, so will their eyes will be open?
In some cases, eyes are open. In some cases, eyes are not open. It depends because we have different, like we have an astral body. We have different levels of bodies, just not the physical body.
Okay, so
the astral. If,
so yeah, their body will be frozen.
The body gets frozen. In a kind of way, it gets frozen.
Why do you think it's
most common one I have seen? The most common one I have seen is people see a black kind of shadow, and then this thing takes over them. It's some kind, sometimes demonic, sometimes it's alien entity. A lot of people have talked about this, and sometimes it's related to alien abduction also. People have talked about alien abductions and all.
Okay, so you think these people who are having psychic attacks, it has something to do with aliens and alien abductions?
I think here at this point of time, we need to define what do we understand when we say the term alien.
When we think of alien, when I think of alien, I think of a species from outside this planet, like how we see in the movies, you know, some lizard man, those kind of imagery come to mind. But what do you think of as alien?
Aliens, what I understand and what I have studied, and my understanding says that aliens are extraterrestrial beings that visit our realm now and then for their own purposes. Aliens are not in general like we say, like they are humanoids or some human-like shaped beings like we see in movies. They are not usually that. They can have no form at all, or they can have any kind of form, because they exist on higher and lower, like different level, kinds of planes other than the physical planes. And usually they don't manifest themselves on the physical planes. It doesn't go with the universal laws.
Do you think aliens have already landed on this planet? Do you think this is just a conspiracy theory, or do you think there is some evidence?
See, for that, we humans perceive things by what, like our past experiences and what we have learned through our entire journey. So what we think as coming, if someone is coming inside the earth, we will think that someone will come on a spaceship, because that's how we perceive things. That's how we think that people can come, because we only, the majority of population thinks that only physical realm exists and people can only enter through physical means like spaceship or UFOs. But these beings mostly travel through portals and other unseen thing. The occult is basically unseen. So they travel through the unseen, through portals. And they are here. They have been here. They will be here. It will keep happening.
Okay. What exactly is occult? What do you mean by occult knowledge?
So if we go into the origin of the term occult, it comes from Latin occultus, and there are three Latin terms: occultus, occultare, and oculus. So they basically mean something that is hidden to the eye, something that is hidden in plain sight, you can say. So occult knowledge is something basically hidden knowledge, something that is hidden to the normal human beings. That is simply occult knowledge. Occult knowledge is not what humans perceive as something demonic or evil. Usually, it is usually perceived like that. But it has both dark and light sides to it.
Okay. With the current situation that's happening with COVID-19 and with the lockdowns, mandatory masking, and vaccine passports, what do you think we can do as individuals to reclaim our freedom? And today is Independence Day, so I think it's the perfect day to talk about reclaiming our freedom.
So on my Instagram, I just put 2-3 stories right now. So the first story was I'll be talking about Independence Day. So we need to understand the term independence. We are independence, in the dependence of something. And when we go into words and their meanings, their hidden meanings, then we understand how we are controlled. So I don't really think that today is an Independence Day. It's just a mock-up. It's a process. It's like you can call it a day when our holographic reality or the illusion we live in, it's to continue that, to maintain that reality. They keep this day to keep the illusion of freedom in people's mind. And as you asked, what can we do to reclaim our freedoms? So we need to become awake to reclaim our freedom. And in order to become awake, we should be aware about the hidden truths of this world. And like I posted a recent series on my Instagram. It's called The Real Pandemics and the Real Solutions. So I discuss in that the real pandemics are fear, lack of courage, lack of care. So these are the real pandemics. And if we work on these pandemics and we work on the solutions I gave is that we should have courage. We should grow a spine. We should speak our truth. We should not care about safety more. And I think some content was released on social media regarding how a safety-driven society becomes more and more sick. I saw it somewhere.
Yeah.
So as more and more you seek safety, you'll start losing your freedom, because they go basically the universe wants to evolve. The universe loves evolving. And the one thing that comes in its way or comes in the way of evolution of universe is cowardness, fear. So anything that will block the evolution of universe and anything that possesses fear and cowardness, that will be removed by universe as a consequence. So we are seeing its physical manifestations right now.
Yeah. How did you become awake, or how did you become courageous to speak the truth?
So courage, as I say, is not lack of fear. It's standing in the face of fear and looking into its eyes. And that's what I have been trying to do. Speak my truth without any fear. And there will always be fear. Like, there will be things like you might get arrested, you might get banned on social media, things like this. These will always be happening, but we can't keep ourselves shut because of that. And my awakening happened as a consequence of a lot of manipulations and a lot of questions I had regarding reality, the kind of problems I faced in the system. The system gave me a lot of trauma. So it created so much resentment that I went into isolation. And then I had questions when I was in that isolation. So that isolation and the trauma that acted as a teacher to me. And when you think of trauma as your enemy or something you try to ignore, then you keep going down and down into darkness and into a place where you can't recognize good and bad. You just need to realize that all of these trauma and the bad stuff that system gives you, it's a teacher. It has come here to teach you. And when you learn from it, then you grow and that trauma goes away.
Okay. So we have to face our trauma rather than hiding from it. And today we see a lot of people trying to hide behind fear, especially with this current situation that's happening right now. And when we talk to these people who we would say is not awake, who are living in fear, who are brainwashed by the mainstream media, how do we communicate with them?
By communicating to their fears and traumas. But what usually happens is when you trigger someone's trauma, it depends on them if they want to become vulnerable with you and if they don't want to become vulnerable. This vulnerability is like, this thing takes a lot of courage to become vulnerable.
Yeah.
And that's what people are lacking right now, the courage. If, when you go down to the very basics, this courage, empathy, fear, this will come on every aspect of human beings.
Yeah, absolutely. And because you think differently and because you live a different life compared to the average person in society, have you lost many friends, or do you see yourself as a black sheep of the family?
Yeah. Just I was reading up a black sheep quote recently only. So, yeah. The like the things are getting redefined. Like as I told, humanity is diverging. So people are getting separated on the very ideological and mental level. If you don't vibrate with people, then they will just go away from you. Like they won't, you can't stay with someone who is not vibing with you.
You keep saying that our society is diverging in two directions. In which two directions are society diverging in?
Okay, so one is the organic timeline. I'll explain this. I'll explain it in terms of timelines or ways. So one is the organic way in which people are speaking their truth. They're not fearful. And they are ready to bear the consequences of speaking the truth. And they are seeking more freedom than safety. And the other group is that is seeking more safety, and they are fearful of what would happen. They are just trying to secure their life, their mortal life. They are not able to realize their eternal essence, that they are truly eternal beings. And it is not just happening on like our plane or our population. It's happening on the higher planes also. So the forces that seek to control us, they are also finite forces, and they know that their only power lies in our fear and we being ignorant. So these people, they reflect those forces that try to control us and that try to keep us in fear. As the forces try to control keep us in fear, so are these people in fear. And we are reflecting, or the awakened beings are reflecting courage and light, because they are not afraid, and they know that even if they die, they are eternal beings. They will just lose this body. And they may come back again.
Interesting. You just mentioned eternal bodies. Where do you think we'll go after we die?
That's a good question. What I have studied is that there are different things that happen when we die. Either you could be in asleep, or you could become awake. It depends on what you have learned throughout your life and what kind of deeds you have done. It depends on a lot of things. So some people just remain asleep. This is a kind of control mechanism. People keep on reincarnating and they think that it's something good, but it's not something good. Reincarnating is reincarnation stops yourself from ascending, from evolving ahead. So that would be a very like detailed topic. What happens when we lose this physical body?
It's very difficult to talk about that also, because I was having a conversation with one more guest, and I asked him, do you think God exists? And his answer was, maybe there is God, maybe there isn't. And even if God exists, in what shape or form does God exist? And then the question keeps on repeating, like, if God exists, who created God? And then who created that? It's like, which came first, chicken or the egg? So what do you think of God?
About God? I will go to the very bottom before answering this question, that this whole thing we see, we perceive through our five senses or the six senses. It all happens to our human brain, the human psyche. And when people lose, the whole agenda is about making people lose their minds, to create an imbalance in their minds, in their psyche. Because the only way to control someone, really control someone, is through their minds. And mental slavery is the greatest form of slavery. So we have two hemispheres in brain, the right hemisphere and the left hemisphere. So when any of these hemisphere gets imbalanced, they create variations in our thinking. You can call it variations in our thinking, or imbalances, you can call it. They create imbalances in the way we think, way we perceive things, and the mind doesn't work in balance as it should. And then we develop a chronic left or right imbalance. And I would like to add a very interesting point here, that when the left brain gets imbalanced, or when the right brain gets imbalanced, these are the kind of imbalance that forces try to create. So are there two kinds of political divisions you would see, the left division and the right division. In around the globe, you will see this, the left and the right. These are the basic classifications around which the political ideology is developed. Because these are the mechanisms that are used to control people, to create imbalances in their mind. The left thinks certain way, the right thinks certain way. And they keep on battling, and they don't realize that the controllers are benefiting out of this. And both the left and the right are just the same thing. And I think we missed on your question.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think the question was about God. Yes.
About God. So there are different. I would try to give more of an insight than my perception, because insight would help people more than perceptions. So there are four paradigms of creations I have read about. The one is the law of one. The another is Big Bang. The another is pure consciousness. And then there is unity consciousness. These are the kind of paradigms people talk about when they talk about creators. And there's a lot of study around creators and gods. And what I feel is that there is one source, the prime essence of creation that there is. I'm talking about the prime essence of creation, not the creators. Creation and creators are two different things. So here I will talk about creation, the prime essence of creation that made the true creation. And something went terrible along the time, and we ended up here as a consequence of that. We were meant for much greater and much better things, but something terrible happened and we ended up here. That's the thing that resonates with me the most. But another thing is that our mind is so powerful that whatever belief you start making, it will start creating the reality around it. So whatever you start believing, that will become real.
Do you think we're living in a matrix, a simulated matrix?
These are very nice questions. Okay, so the Matrix as we, what is your reference of the Matrix?
Mine mostly is the movie. So, okay, okay. You know how we don't really have control. We think that we have free will, but even that free will is designed in a way for us to believe there is free will. In reality, we actually don't have any free will. This is sort of like a game, or there is some there's someone at a higher level controlling all of this, and this is just a game or a play, and we are just characters with no real free will. That is my idea of the Matrix.
Okay. I would go back to the word universe here.
Okay.
So the word universe means universe. That means one verse. Verse usually means song or a movie or some kind of scene. Okay. Let's, for this instance, let's take it as a movie. Okay, or a simulation, if you say. So we are in a universe. We are in one simulation, like a one CD. One CD, it's revolving. So one movie is getting played and played and played and played and played. And that same movie keeps getting played and again and again and again. That is called the universe. Because we are stuck in a universe. But we are multiversal beings. Multidimensional beings. And but there are many different meanings of what is a matrix. And there's a Plato's allegory, Plato's cave allegory, from which the matrix was taken, like the idea of matrix was taken. It was like the people were in a cave and the whole world for them was the cave only. So the matrix exists, but as you go, like if you go into esoteric knowledge, then we read about different kinds of matrix, time matrix, soul matrix, and etc. But the matrix does exist. It, my idea of matrix is like an onion. So we are in the outermost layer of onion. And there are different layers of matrix. And in the center is the source, the prime source of creation. That is unified. That doesn't have any layer. That is complete in itself. And there are a lot of layers.
There are people, there are rationalist people. They only look at things in a very rational way. And even I'm also sort of a rationalist. But there are people who will listen to what you're saying and they won't entertain you at all. They will say, okay, this guy's crazy, he's a conspiracy theorist. Nothing that he says makes sense. Oh, what do you think of rationalists and the rational way of thinking?
So I will go to the words. Words are very important. I will say here that words are very important. You need to dissect words to dissect into the universe reality that our controllers have created for us. Because these words act as a portal. They are a two-pointed sword. They are used by our controllers for us to keep us under control, and they can be used by us also to pierce through the reality. So I'll go to the word intelligence here. So the intelligence word is made of intelligence. So intelli comes from the intellectual part of the brain that you're talking about, rational thinking. And then there is gens. Gens is the generative capacity that humans have. So pure and true intelligence or holistic intelligence is both the combination of rationalization and the true creative capacity, the intuition, the emotion part. Yeah, that comes from the right brain, and the logic that and rationality that comes from the left brain. And when they combine and they work in balance, that is what when the healthy mind perceives without any filters. So people who think only rationally or logically, and they say that they only believe in evidence, they are basically left-minded, or they have chronic left brain imbalance. And many scientists, if you see in the like our world, all the people who are considered intellectuals, or they are seen very high, they are seen as very high people or very intellectual or very knowledgeable people, they are all left-brain imbalanced people. They are intellectuals, not intelligent people. I would call them retards. I won't take name, but even the great scientists who claim that there is no God, it's totally left-brain imbalance. All the doctors, scientists who like make the rules and make the mechanism of how the world works, they're all left-minded people.
But should we use our left mind a little bit? Should we use logic and rational thinking? Because it leads to success to a certain extent. Because in order to become a successful doctor, engineer, astronaut, in order to build things, in order, you know, for us to communicate like this, someone made Zoom, and I'm sure even that person is slightly left-brained. So is it useful to think from the left brain to a certain extent, I would say even excessively?
The person who made the backend of the Zoom must be left brained. But the person who made the appearance, or who chose the colors of the logo, or who made the logo, who made the appearance, the front interface of the Zoom,
the creative person,
that person was right brained.
Okay.
Yeah. So what I feel is that we should use both in balance. That is what it means to be awake. To use both the left brain and the right brain in balance. If there is any kind of imbalance in left or right, it will lead to things, bad things. They're not good for us. It will basically lead to things that will harm us only eventually. And I would like to ask those people who ask for evidences, that do you have the courage to walk the path that goes to the evidence? There are evidences. Even in the spiritual sciences, there are evidences. But they would straight away deny the evidences because they think, because their mind doesn't perceive it only. They don't have the capabilities in their brain to perceive that. So you can't just do anything about it.
Okay. And one more thing that I want to talk about is self-improvement. In today's society, people have abandoned responsibility. They've abandoned self-responsibility. They want the government to take care of us. They want some church or some temple to take care of us. Someone else's taxpayers' money to take care of us. We have become so weak. We have become so incapable. How do you think we as individuals can improve our lives today?
In one line, I would say by stopping our silence, or by not being silent. So again, I would go to the word silent, and I would try to explain it, that the word silent comes from sigh and lent. It basically means lenting your sigh. And sigh is a kind of passive yes. If you understand, like if you passively want to say yes to something, you would sigh. So when you are lenting your sigh to someone, you are basically saying passively, you are saying yes to someone. So unless they start speaking up, and if people will remain silent, then things will not work up. So the society, it has gone so bad that it has happened over the years. It's not that these people have achieved this totalitarian or like authority kind of stuff that's happening right now. They have not achieved it in 1 day or 2 days or 1 month or 5 years. As far as I have researched, it has gone like it has began since the time of Nimrod. There was a king Nimrod. This attempt for world global dominance and the new world order, as we know, the prime minister spoke about it today also. Our prime minister is speaking so loudly about the new world order, and he's telling that the media is not covering it in a very good way. It's not covering it enough, the new world order. See the amount of courage he has.
You think he's trying to leave us clues? Modi is trying to leave us clues. Like, he keeps saying new world order. Like, listen to what I'm saying.
He's not, basically he knows the kind of clowns and cowards and ignorant people we have in India especially. I'm not happy to say this, but like people would say that I'm saying to my own country and all that. But see, the truth is truth.
Yeah.
And you could see there is zero resistance to any kind of tyranny that's happening in India. If we compare it from the all of the world, like are the people from different countries mad that they are protesting so much against this? So this attempt for global domination has been happening since at least almost 5,000 years, and they have been attempting and escalating it, and then losing it again, escalating and losing it again. And this is a part of it, this escalation that's happening right now. Because this time they know that it's final. This time, if they don't do it, they are losing it all. They have broken a lot of universal laws and they are facing the consequences of it.
Who do you think will win this time? Who do you think has an upper hand?
Okay, it's not about more about winning, it's about choosing. Nobody wins or loses in the eternal life. Either you learn or either you evolve. So if they don't learn, like there are things that I would not want to disclose right here because they are so scary that it will be too much for people. It's related to soul and losing your soul and getting harvested by dark satanic entities, and it's happening right now. As people are getting their treatments, so as a consequence of it, their soul is getting compromised and they are getting hijacked by these entities. And that's why a lot of people have started behaving differently. And even today I read that in one of the spiritual communities, I read that people are getting hijacked. Like anything, like people, basically what happens is they have a personality, and the next day you meet, there'll be something they were not at all, totally opposite, like some kind of polarity disorder, bipolar disorder, you can say. So these are the kind of stuff that is happening, and people, as they think on only physical level, they are not able to understand this. It's basically on their free will. We can't do, like, you can't do much about it. It's their free will. If they are going to choose that, then they are going to choose that. And we have to go to a higher place. They will something will happen to them, and I will not talk about it because it's too painful to speak about it here. It's not just about losing body. It's not even losing about soul. It's even worse than that. So, but the creation is very, very balanced and neutral. So the creation still will do good to them.
And in that kind of a hostile world, how do we preserve ourselves and our character? Because it will become more and more difficult for us to be ourselves.
Yeah, this is that only, the test of our spiritual authenticity and our how grounded we can be right now. That's real, very hard test right now. And this is the test we need to pass. And what I would say is staying grounded and being neutral, or at 0 point, I would say. Neutrality is a very good concept. And I might teach it in my sessions soon. So being neutral and staying grounded is the only thing I would suggest. If you can't do anything, then do these, because these would help a lot. Because there are a lot of deviations coming up this year. This year is going to be next level stuff.
So you don't think there will be 2022?
No, I think there will be 2022 and 2023. But it will be very intense, very, very intense.
Okay. You know, in my call with you previously, you said that for a while you were living off grid. Without internet, without electricity. How was this experience, and what was the purpose behind living off grid?
The purpose was to, initially it was to establish an off grid, but I didn't get a very good response from the people, because the people are busy. They are just still transcending from their old ways of living. So I did this because I know that it's basically the two timelines, or the two ways people are diverging, I told you. One way, when we live organically, we are getting close to nature. So that's what I wanted to experience at that point of time. So I went very close to nature, and I learned things from the ground, and that is very essential, because all of it, when you see, like, if anyone doesn't want to go into occult knowledge and esoterics, the most important thing right now, if they can understand, is this is a war between artificial and natural. So we have been thriving in an artificial environment for so long that we don't know what true nature is, because the food is artificial. We don't grow our food, but we still get it. And the people who are growing our food, they are not getting the food. So this is total reversal of realities. The first person who should get the food is those who grow the food. And it's happening total artificially, and we are on artificial money matrix, and money is total illusion. And this population outgrowth is also artificial, because we have been given too much of leisure and too much of kind of health services that sustain our life, not make it better, but it's like an animal farm. You are not making the animal more healthy. You are just increasing its life so that you have a greater food stock. Because earlier people used to live on risks, and they used to prefer freedom over safety. So they used to die early, around 50s and 60s. That was the max. They used to die at 30s also. So life was not long, but big and great. So the society used to thrive. Now the life is long and lazy and lame and artificial, but it's not great at all.
Yes, I think we're living like domestic animals. All these devices that are given to us, all these cell phones and the social media, Instagram reels, TikTok videos, this is like grains that we feed to the cattle just to fatten them before we kill them. That sort of thing.
The screen of nature is always white. If you see the sky at in the morning or the sun, I won't talk about the moon, but I will talk about the sun. So the screen of the nature is always white, but the screen of artificiality is always black. That's why we have black screens on phone and laptops. It's inorganic stuff.
And what is now, let's say we start living off grid. Many of us start living off grid, or not necessarily living off grid, but we move away from big cities. We move into smaller communities. We are interested in self-reliability. One important concept that comes to mind is agorism. What do you think of agorism, and how do you think we can inculcate agorism in our lives?
Okay, so agorism, we can build small markets. Agorism means basically barter system only. It means barter. It comes from the word agora, and agora means market. So in Greece, people used to have marketplaces, open source markets. So the open source means, and nothing is hidden in that. If you're buying an organic apple, then it's 100% organic only, nothing mixed. So that kind of honesty driven and peer-to-peer market. And no third person should be involved in that. So basically there should be no taxation. So the concept of tax is totally removed from agorist markets. And if you want to buy something from me, then you'll give me something that I need, and I'll give you that service, whatever you want. And the only people involved will be you and me. No other person will have anything to do with this. And no one can tax us on that. Because it's our energy that we are putting into that service. And how is the third person legible for taking a part of our money or whatever produce or whatever it is when he's not involved only? It's like stealing.
Yeah. So taxation is theft.
Yeah, theft. It's theft.
Are you an anarchist also then? Because I feel like you are the kind of person who would not care about the legitimacy of the government.
Yeah, I don't care about the legitimacy of government. Anarchist. There's a lot of things happening in the anarchist community right now. So I'm freedom loving, I would say.
Okay. Whatever.
I don't have any problem with the concept of anarchy, but there are a lot of things that are not being talked about in the anarchist communities. And like the kind of world we have made right now, going into anarchy is not something sustainable that would be. Because there are people of different mindsets. Anything, there are a lot of things. That's why I would say I am freedom loving over anarchy. But I am not against anarchy.
Yeah, same here. Even I am also confused about anarchy. I don't know if I can call myself an anarchist, because I'm not entirely sure what it would be, how the world would be if there is anarchy. Even I would say I'm a freedom loving person, more freedom, more personal choice, more liberties. And what is your opinion on the rules that are happening right now that take away our freedoms, like vaccine passports, for example.
What do you want me to say?
Like about vaccine, you know, these vaccine passports in Kerala, they recently said you can't go to a shop without having vaccine certificate or RT-PCR certificate. It's obviously violating our personal liberty. What do you think of this, and how do you think we should fight back?
I think the when we talk about things like this, the one of the major conflicts that comes in conversation, or the one of the major rocks or hurdles that comes in the conversation, is collectivism or collective or community. The word of community comes here. So if the collective wants to take on the tyrannies or the rules, if they want it to be implemented, then what can we do about it? That is the question. If there are 10 people living in a community and 8 of them want that, we want to be ruled by someone very badly, then what can you do about it? The 2 people would have to leave that place. That's why we need, this is the time that we go towards the solutions, that we, like-minded people, we start making our own community and we start living there. We grow our own food and we do our own business and we exchange services with each other, and then we can like live, and then nobody will be there to say that now you can't do anything here, because everyone wants their freedom. If all the freedom loving people start living together, no one would say that you can't have freedom.
I think this is already happening in the digital space with the alt tech exodus. People are leaving YouTube, they're going to BitChute, people are leaving WhatsApp and Instagram and moving to Telegram. Are you on board with the alt tech exodus, and where do you think, in what direction do you think this will go?
It's good. I am not like against this. It's good that people are choosing alternative platforms for free speech and expressing themselves. But what is very crucial right now is taking action on the physical plane. This is taking action on the digital plane. Taking action on the physical plane is very important, because we are being attacked on the physical plane a lot.
And what do you think will happen with the cryptocurrencies? Now people are getting paranoid with cash, with digital cash. What is your opinion on cryptocurrencies?
I don't like have much of opinions on cryptocurrency. Some people see. So the community, I would tell you what I have heard in community, is that some people say that it is controlled and things like that. If you study crypto, then you come to a realization that it can't actually be controlled. But there are cases like there are currencies by IBM, cryptocurrencies by IBM, and they are operating. So there's a lot of confusion around crypto as of now. I can't say that. I can't say anything with surety about crypto right now. And I'm not too much into crypto, so I'm not the like the very best person to ask this question.
You think barter transaction is the best right now with this agorist mentality?
I think before that, if people actually want to do barter, what I feel is that even if 10 people come together and stay at a place and grow their own food and learn that. Because when I went off grid, what I did is that I learned all of this one. Growing our own food, lighting up a fire in forest. And it seems so easy when you see it on paper, but it's like very, very difficult when you do it actually. Lighting up a fire when it's like raining, and actually living in a tent and stuff like that. So if even if 10 people start doing that and start sharing their knowledge and come together and share their ideas, then a lot can change. And then barter can eventually evolve whatever they decide, whatever the people. The basic concept of agorism is a very open concept. So the principle is peer-to-peer transactions. So whatever, if we are doing agorism, you and me, we will decide the terms and nobody else, and we will settle whatever happens. So it agorism will vary from community to community. It is not a very defined set of rules that you have to do agorism in like this only, because it's not centralized, it's very decentralized.
And finally, what do you think is the purpose of life?
This question is the greatest question. What I have learned till now in my lifetime. So I think the purpose of life is to experience and evolve. Experience and evolve. Evolve is the way to go. If you evolve, then let all this tyranny and bullshit come. Nothing can stop you. Because when you evolve, universe is by your side, because universe wants to evolve.
Yeah. So we are being compatible with the universe.
Yeah.
Very nice. Yeah. Even I kind of align with that. Thank you so much, Baba Yaga, for coming on the podcast. This was a pleasure.
It was a pleasure for me also.